Hello, a warm welcome to all the distinguished panelists and delegates. As you know, now we are turning into our concluding session, the so-called lighting talks. I would like just to remind you that we are running in parallel two sessions, one on energy. For those that are interested and sign up for this session, please stay online. And if you would like, you know, to switch to the one on transport, please follow the instruction and the links that you receive through the chat. Thank you very much. We will start. We will give some time for people to self-select their preference. And in the meantime, you see, if you're speaking here, this is your set of speakers that will do a very rich program. My name is Maria Vagliasindi. I'm lead economist in the infrastructure vice president's office. And it is my honor and my privilege to chair this lighting talk on energy decarbonization. This session will bring together some leading experts from academia and think tanks from all around the world to share experience and insight for their recent experience and research related to decarbonizing the energy system. We have in front of us, as you can see, a very rich program, and we will benefit from the perspective not only of economists, but also from social scientists, engineers, and so on and so forth. To make the job of our panelists that we would like to thank very much for participating even more challenging, we ask them to deliver their presentation at the speed of light, as you can see. Just turning to the topic, one moment from my side, incredible innovation and advances in data, analytics, and connectivity are enabling us in the energy sector to face a new future where ideally we will be able to identify where the needs are coming from, and deliver any services at the right time, in the right space, and at the lowest cost. The electricity sector has been really at the heart of the digital transformation, which have been enabled a smart demand response, critical to maintain and also to keep the flexibility needed to integrate it, more generation for renewable and for delivering even more. The first set of presentation will touch upon the disruptive role of distributed energy resources. So without any further views, I'm delighted to introduce Derek Malapragata, research scientist at MIT Energy Initiative, who will focus his presentation on the role of storage in a new world characterized by increasing renewable energy. Derek, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Maria. I'm just going to try to get my presentation up very quickly. Let me know if you can see it.
Yes, all is working. Thank you.
Thanks. So thank you to the organizers for inviting me. My name is Derek Malapragada. Today, I'd like to tell you a little bit about the work we've been doing in the area of energy storage economics and its role in the energy transition, particularly as we think about the decarbonization of the electricity system. So if I can get this. Yep. So the sort of the motivation for this work is stemming from the fact that energy storage is increasingly attracting a lot of attention, both in the US and in other parts of the world, as the costs for battery storage technologies are coming down. One of the unique things about energy storage is its ability to provide a variety of grid services, ranging from frequency regulation all the way to enabling dispatchability of renewables resources at scale. And in the US, we have seen sort of the role for energy storage slowly evolving from primarily a resource operating in the frequency regulation market to increasingly being able to co-locate and integrate with renewables to be able to make them more dispatchable. This trend is likely to continue going forward as we think about the cost projections that are out there for battery storage technologies, particularly lithium-ion battery storage technologies. So one of the questions that that comes up as we think about this evolving trajectory is, what is the potential role for energy storage in the future electricity system? And how is that role influenced by both its own technology and cost evolution, but also the system factors that are likely to impact energy storage as it's not a generation resource on its own? So to address this question, we recently published a paper that looked at the system value of battery storage in the bulk power system with increasing wind and solar penetration. The main motivation of this work was to understand from the value side what energy storage has to offer for the electricity system when considering a variety of grid services ranging from energy, network deferral, ancillary services and capacity, and how that value would likely compare with the cost of energy storage, particularly battery energy storage in the form of lithium ion systems, and how this value is likely to be impacted by all the other dynamics that are happening on the grid today. So I'd like to give you just two snippets of analysis from this paper. So we looked at a system that resembles systems in the US Northeast and in Texas. And we were looking at a system that has some amount of existing brownfield capacity, mostly in the form of natural gas generation. And within those systems, we basically experimented and tried to evaluate how does the system value of energy storage, which is the value that the reduction in system cost that energy storage penetration would enable, how that value basically changes as a function of energy storage deployment, as a function of percentage of peak demand, as well as we are changing the renewables penetration in the system on an annual generation basis, going from 40% to 60%. So what you see on this chart is basically a trend where the value of energy storage generally is expected to increase as we deploy more renewables in the electricity system, which makes sense given the variability that these resources add to the mix. But at the same time, energy storage also has a challenge in that as we are adding more energy storage into the grid, there is increased competition between energy storage resources, which results in a declining marginal value for subsequent resources that are added on. So as we think about these two combined effects and compare the value that energy storage could provide against what its costs are today, we find that today's costs are still quite high when we think about sort of the need for energy storage as we think about integrating more and more renewables in the system. But future cost production projections indicate that there's a possibility for significant energy storage to be penetrated where the value exceeds their costs. Now, another point I want to highlight is that much of this value stems from displacing capacity rather than reducing operating costs of the system. So the chart on the left basically shows you a breakdown of the value coming from a number of different resources, ranging from network deferral, capacity deferral, and changes in the thermal plant startups and the dispatch of the power system. There's a lot of detail on this chart, but what I would ask you to focus on is basically the purple and the golden bars here, which are basically reflecting the value that is coming from displacing VRE generation or renewables generation, as well as the value that's coming from displacing transmission. So these tend to dominate the overall values that energy storage provides to the system. So one key takeaway here is that as we think about storage deployment to maximize value in power system applications, near-term applications could involve coupling and co-locating renewables and storage projects that could monetize some of this capacity deferral value that storage provides. And so you see that kind of activity happening both in the US and in many other regions. Finally, I want to sort of just pivot from the US analysis to just talk a little bit about how this impacts the role for storage in developing economies like India. So in many of these regions, we are seeing large increases in electricity consumption from a number of different sectors. And in India in particular, we see a lot of that increase coming in from the building sector resulting from air conditioning adoption. Now, air conditioning is unique in that it drives up not only the total consumption, but it also changes the nature of the peak demand and when it occurs. And so those structural changes in the load shape are also going to have an impact on the amount of storage that one would need in the system. And so really, when we think about the value of storage, we not only have to think about the supply side dynamics, such as renewables integration, but also have to think about the demand side dynamics, such as the kind of appliances that are being added on the electricity system, particularly in developing economies. So to highlight this point here, I'm just showing you one example from some of our own modeling work, where we look at a 2050 scenario and a summer week dispatch in the Indian electricity system, where we assume the efficiency of air conditioning appliances follows historical trends. And what one sees is that you see these large peaks that typically tend to occur at later hours in the evening, offset from the solar generation times, where storage shown in the brown plays a significant role to discharge to meet those hours of peak electricity consumption. If you now look at the an alternative scenario where we assume AC efficiency improves in line with IEA projections, then that peak load is significantly shaved and energy storage requirements are consequently reduced significantly. So the key takeaway here is that energy storage and demand side elements are intricately tied as they are when you think about other supply side dynamics. So with that, I'll stop and just highlight that the main takeaways around some of the work we have looked at regarding the value of storage results mainly point to the fact that capacity deferral is a key value source for energy storage, and there are many ways to monetize that today. And as we think about developing country grids and the role for storage, the changing demand side is a key factor to keep in mind from end users like air conditioning and EV deployment. With that, I'll stop and turn it back to Maria. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Derek, for such a fascinating presentation. We will continue turning and keeping in the topic of disruption coming from distributed generation. It is my privilege now to introduce the next speaker, Professor Prudence Dato, who is an assistant professor at the University of Basel, who will focus on the role of smart grid in a new decentralized grid, where we have presence of a lot of disruption coming from prosumer. Prudence, the floor is yours.
So thanks, Maria. And I would like also to thank the organizer for inviting me for this conference. So today I'm going to present, I want to talk about how smart grid technologies can contribute to fighting climate change. And this talk is based on a recent paper that has been published in Energy Economist and focus on the recent attentions that smart grid technologies and demand side management for households have received, both in the academic literature and also in the media. And in addition, many countries have set ambitious objectives for a massive smart meter rollout. As for instance, EU European Union commissions have set a target of 80% of a massive rollout of smart meters by 2020. However, all these studies and also the design of the policy do not consider some important economic aspects. That's what basically we are doing here. So the motivation of the talk here is based on some of the recent reports from IPCC. You all know that human activities are responsible for climate change. And more specifically, energy sector represent more than 2/3 of the overall greenhouse gas emissions. In this context, energy transitions to renewable energy is one of the key solutions today to fight climate change, right? So this is the good news, but this comes also with some challenges. The problem here is that by relying on renewable energy sources, those are already intermittent and we cannot predict them. So this brings new challenge in terms of the grid management. The challenge are basically the reliability of the energy systems and also the security of the system. The good news here is that smart grid technology provides solutions to deal with the issue of reliability and also the security of the energy system. If you look at the right-hand side of the slide, you have the figure showing what is different now in terms of what we expect in the future regarding smart grid technology compared to the past and the present. There will be some communications between the production, transmission, and distribution, and also end user, including consumer. While we know that these smart grid technologies can provide solutions in terms of demand side management, this also can generate some rebound effects that will lead to more consumption of electricity, and this may also affect the welfare of the household. So in this context, the first question and the main question that we ask in this paper is the fact that many countries are now planning for a massive rollout of smart meter. Do we see this as a good solution? What do we really mean by good solutions? These two things. The first one, when we are in the context of a household that is equipped with smart technologies, like smart meters, solar panels, storage like battery, and also have flexibility to sell electricity to the grid or buy electricity from the grid via net metering, do we see or can we see any increase of the electricity consumed by the household? And the second question that is important is, do we also see in this context of smart grid technologies any increase or decrease of the household welfare? Those are the two main questions that we are trying to answer in these papers. And we basically find two main results. The first one is that smart meters can motivate households to consume more electricity from the grid at one condition when the discrepancy between the fixed tariff without smart meter and the expected tariff with smart meter is small. This is less likely to happen, for instance, in countries in which we have currently low electric tariff, like in Hong Kong, but it's more likely that this will happen in countries when we have currently high electric price, like in the UK. When we also base on this result that with smart meters, households can consume more electricity from the grid, if the grid, the energy electricity mix from the grid is based more on the fossil fuel, then it is possible that smart meters can induce high greenhouse emissions, which is not what is expected in terms of demand side management for smart meter rollout. The second result that we find in terms of welfare impact is that smart meter can also have a negative effect on the welfare of the household, in the sense that the benefits that the household can get from the rollout of the smart meters is not sufficient to cover the installation cost of smart meters. However, we also find that when there is a public policy in place that provides full subsidies for a rollout of smart meters, it is less likely that the rollout will negatively affect the welfare of the household. So to conclude, we came up with some policy recommendations in the sense that nationwide deployment of smart meters needs for sure some regulatory measures. Regulatory measure, what we mean by that is that the dynamic pricing that comes with smart meters alone is not sufficient to attain the objective of demand side management. Tariff needs to be regulated with smart meters. The second set of recommendations that we can provide from these studies is also in order to support the negative effects that smart meter rollouts can have on household welfare, we will suggest that rollouts of smart meter should be accompanied with full subsidizations in order to reduce the burden that this can have on the household welfare. So thanks for your attention.
Thank you very much for the excellent presentation. And again, since this is a lightning talk, also a lightning question that come from the audience. What would be, and it's for both of you, what would be the pitch that you would do for a Minister of Finance or a Minister of Energy to convince them about, you know, making an argument that it would be important to scale up energy storage in your case, for the deployment of smart grid? Tarek, very quickly, 1 second.
Yeah. I mean, energy storage is critical for renewables integration long term, and renewables integration is because of the nature of their resource, sort of has many different social and economic development opportunities. So I would kind of tie the message around energy storage deployment as being integral to that.
And Prudence, from your side.
From my side, I will say that to reconcile both sides of the Minister of Energy and the finance, I will say that there is should be the implementation of this type of subsidies for the smart meters, because it is costly for the government to subsidize, but this has some spillover, because by providing subsidies to smart meters, this will also support more integrations of renewable energy into the grids, and this have implications in terms of climate change.
Thank you very much indeed. We will use your advice when we are interacting with policymakers, and we'll let you know whether this works. Turning now to a very important topic, particularly in this post-COVID crisis. The European Commission has announced right now the largest stimulus package ever financed through the EU budget for a greener, more digital, and more resilient Europe. Within this package, there is also the Just Transition Mechanism and Fund, which is aimed at overcoming the economic and social cost of the climate transition, particularly in the most vulnerable coal and carbon intensive region. It is my privilege now to provide the floor to Ian Witajewski-Boltwich, who is associate professor at the University of Warsaw and is also working very closely with the World Bank, guiding us through the challenges of a just transition in the case of Poland. Ian, I would like to turn to you.
Okay. Hello, everyone. Thank you very much for the opportunity to present this research. The topic of research, the topic of this presentation is what are the consequences of low carbon transition, but from the perspective of workers. I hope you can see my screen. So let me start with the time frame. So the slide you can see is a demand for workers. The demand for coal. In global demand for coal under the scenario of limiting the increase in the global average temperature to 1.5 degrees.
We still don't see your, now it's perfect. Thank you so much. There is a slight delay, perfect. So just to signal.
Okay. So this slide is showing the demand for coal under the ambitious mitigation scenario, and it gives a time frame. So it's drawn by integrated assessment models. The solid line is the global consumption for coal. The dotted line is the OECD consumption. For each, you see the three lines is because they are for three different assumptions regarding the mitigation challenges. But irrespective of the challenges, the message is clear. When you look at the solid line, we have around 20 years to phase out coal. And when you look at the OECD countries, it's even shorter. We have to decarbonize, we have to move away from coal by 2030. And for countries like Poland, which is part of OECD, this means that we have 10 years from now to reduce the production of coal to zero. And this also means reducing the employment in mining sector to zero. So let me focus on Poland, which is the main subject of my studies and my research. In Poland, we have 80,000 workers who work in the mining sector. They are localized in one region, in Silesia, and in this region, they constitute around 5% of the workforce. So a big mass of workers that must be moved to other sectors. And the question of my research program is whether it comes at the cost, whether it means some costs for, it involves some costs for those workers. However, before talking about costs, let me present the profile. So on the left side of the graph, you see the age structure of miners in Poland. The first column shows for mining. And let me first point out that this gray and yellow region, they show that around 33%, one third of miners are above 45 years old. And that's good news, because that means that in 10 years, most of them will be retired. Still, there is two thirds, around 70% of workers who are below 45, and in 10 years they will be still in the labor market, and they will have to go to the other to find a job in other sectors. And one reason this movement might not be trivial is the right side of the slide, which shows the education. And as you see, they are not very well educated Only 16% of miners have tertiary education compared to 33% in Polish economy. So, you know, occasionally I see photos of miners doing programming, ex-miners who are doing programming and now working in IT sector. But looking at this graph, I think it happened on large scale. Certainly most of the workers who now work in mining will have to find simple, low-skilled jobs in either construction or manufacturing, or simple services. And you can ask, so what? What's the problem about moving from one skilled job to another low-skilled job? Well, what's the cost of such movement? And well, it's still, even such simple movement might involve cost for workers. And let me give you microeconomic argument why. So imagine a worker, a miner, he can be 30 years old. His education that he got, given the experience that he accumulated over years in his career, given his network, given his preferences, this miner chooses to work in mining. Assuming that he's rational, this means that mining is his first best. From all sectors, mining gives him the highest payoff. If we eliminate jobs in mining, he necessarily will have to choose the second best. But always moving from first best to second best involves cost. And we actually built a model to compute what is the cost of movement for workers. And when you aggregate these costs across workers, we got to 0.5% of GDP. So from macroeconomic perspective, it's not this huge cost, but still it's noticeable. And you might ask, well, hold on a second, how come mining could be a first best for anyone? It's such a tough, difficult job. So let me, So part of the answer is on this graph. First of all, miners are earning
Your voice is breaking. Perhaps you can turn, you know, the video off to be more clear. Sorry for interrupting.
Yeah, thank you. Wait, I'll try to find. Well, if I know how to do that. Okay.
Please go ahead.
Yes. So that's so the graph you see is the distribution of wages in mining sector, the red bars, and the white bars behind us, the distribution of wages in manufacturing. And you see that the wage in mining, the median wage in mining is approximately twice as high as the median wage in the manufacturing. So obviously they are afraid of losing the salaries and afraid of going to other sectors. Still, you might ask, well, if I give you a choice whether you want to work for $5,000 in a grocery shop or $2,000 in extremely difficult conditions, dangerous, tough job, physical work in the mining sector, underground, most of us, probably including me, we would choose to work in a grocery shop. The point is that miners are different. From the beginning, from the kindergarten, they were taught that mining is noble. Yes, it's hard work. But this hard work is critical, is very important for functioning of the economy, functioning of the country. So they think that, yes, this work is hard, but it's noble. And you give them another choice, choice to work in the manufacturing, they will not think it's such a splendid idea. They don't think it's such a great choice, especially given that most probably they'll earn half of what they earn now. Let me also present some answers. What can we do about it? By we, I mean research community, policymakers, experts. So first answer, well, we can provide guidance. We can expect, we can manage expectations of investors and workers who are at the beginning of their career. So by providing them projections of the future, by giving them signals which sectors are growing and which sectors are declining, we can prevent a lot of wasteful investment. And by investment, I don't mean only the investment related to assets or infrastructure. I also mean investment in human capital. So we must avoid a situation in which young workers are investing their time in order to acquire skills that are useful only in mining. They will not be able to apply anywhere else. And the second advice is to acknowledge the cost. So miners know that outside mining, the jobs are either beyond their reach or they give them, the jobs give them much lower salaries. So we have to acknowledge that yes, transition will be costly, it will involve cost. And if there are means, if we have such possibilities, then we can negotiate and try to compensate them for those losses. Thank you very much. I hope I'm on time.
Thank you very much, Ian, for such a convincing presentation. Let's turn now from the challenges to the opportunities of decarbonizing the economy, the European economy, by 2050. So it is my pleasure to introduce Francesco Dolci, Scientific Officer at the Joint Research Center of the European Commission. And his role will be to convince us what hydrogen can be used in several ways as a feedstock, as a fuel, as an energy carrier, as a storage, and as many applications that can make this green transition real. Francesco, I would like to turn to you.
Well, thank you very much. Good afternoon to everyone, and thank you very much to your dear organizer for giving me the opportunity to present some preliminary results of our work, which is ongoing at the moment. I will focus mainly on transport of hydrogen in this flash presentation. Time is tyrant. And I will immediately dive in. First, just a quick slide. I'm working for the European Commission, but I'm working in the Joint Research Center of the European Commission. For those of you who are not familiar, we are providing technological opinion-based advice to the policymakers in Brussels, but we're not involved directly in defining the policy agenda. We're mainly involved with knowledge management and technology monitoring. A bit of context. So hydrogen is a hot topic. Probably you're already aware that the European Commission issued a hydrogen strategy earlier on this summer. There are different, it's quite articulated, but we can see some main targets for the near future, and we can see how the amount of hydrogen involved in this strategy, the ambition, is quite big, it's quite significant. We are talking about megatons, several megatons of renewable hydrogen, and within this strategy is explicitly acknowledge that in some cases, at least, hydrogen will likely have to be transported from areas where renewables are abundant to areas where demand for this hydrogen will be present. And transport can be performed in several different ways. We can have different carriers, but we can have different transport means. So considering this, in the GSC, we start investigating what would it be the best option, or the best options, or what are the advantages and disadvantages, what are the key points we should focus our attention on if we really want to have performant transport chains for this hydrogen. This is more or less how our methodology. These are, as I said, preliminary results, so things can still be tweaked before the final report is published. Hopefully this will happen soon. But the carriers we focus our attention on are compressed hydrogen, liquid organic hydrogen carriers, methanol, ammonia, and we consider several transportation modes. We survey literature, papers, report. We build databases with key information. We focus on, I will be speaking mainly on cost, on prices in this presentation, but we have information on energy, and the next step will be on environmental impacts. After we've got a database. We define some possible cases, some possible scenarios, and we come up with a breakdown of the different impacts. Hydrogen production costs are not included in this analysis. This is just about transportation, and we focus mainly on transportation. I talk about scenarios. These are two examples. Case A, case B. For reasons of time, I will focus only on case A, which is a bit more simple. We have a large amount of hydrogen produced in a southern region, and it's transported in a northern region. Case B involves a smaller amount of hydrogen, and the distribution is a bit more capillary and involves multimodal transport. So I'll not go there. But in both cases, we perform a sort of sensitivity analysis with high electricity cost and low electricity cost. And we try to understand how much our assumptions impact the final cost. So without further ado, I'll show you the first results for case A, which is production of a large amount in a region far away from the delivery point, roughly speaking, 2,500 kilometers. On the left, you've got the case for pipelines with high cost. On the right, for pipelines with low cost, you see that compressed hydrogen within the assumptions of our database, of our tool, is performing quite well. In the case of ammonia and methanol, we have a significant handicap, which is the use of the carrier itself for providing the energy required to crack the carrier back to hydrogen. In the case of liquid organic hydrogen carrier, we have a different situation depending on whether we have availability of cheap heat or not. And a similar situation for shipping. We have compressed and liquid hydrogen as a good solution. Again, a penalty for ammonia and methanol if the energy required to produce again hydrogen is coming from the carrier itself. And we can see how the difference between the carriers becomes smaller if electricity becomes cheaper. That was it. That was more or less an excursus on our preliminary results. These are the takeaway messages within the limits of our models. We've seen that transport within Europe can be cost effective if there is a difference between the production point and the distribution point, which we quantified roughly around one euros per kilogram of hydrogen. Gaseous hydrogen pipelines come out quite well, and the operation doesn't seem to be influenced that much on the cost of electricity, but rather on the capex of the infrastructure. Liquid hydrogen and liquid organic hydrogen carriers can perform quite well within certain boundaries, and ammonia and methanol have the biggest handicap of being used as fuel themselves for recovering hydrogen from the carrier. Thank you very much for the attention.
Thank you very much, Francesco, for the insight of this new research, and we look forward to seeing it published. I have just a couple of questions that come from the audience. One is from Ian. You've been talking about transition in a way and providing opportunity, new opportunity for, you know, allowing people to get access to jobs, perhaps jobs that pays as well as mining. what about opportunity that comes from green jobs? That is one question from Ian. And for Francesco, since your presentation has been focusing, obviously so, this is an emerging technology and on the application to some European country, what would you think would be how we can make the case for developing country? Is there any research and light in this? Let me just give the floor to Ian first, and then you're going next.
Yeah, I think it's a very good question, a very important point. What about these green jobs and the salaries? I'll keep my video off just to make sure that the connection is good. So what about the green jobs and the salaries there? So this coin has two sides. When we compute the cost of transition from the energy system cost perspective, when we compute the cost of new technologies, we assume that those technologies are produced with the market prices, market wages. If we want to increase this salaries in green job in green industry above the market wages, then those technologies will also become more expensive, and the electricity prices will go up. So yeah, if we want to give very good salaries in the green industry, you would have to increase the cost for the electricity and the cost on the consumer side. So and if we don't, then the market salaries are as they are, and in the manufacturing, looking at the manufacturing low skill jobs, because of course there are a variety of jobs, but low skill jobs in manufacturing are still not that well paid. So I'm afraid that that even the green jobs will not be able to compensate miners for their loss.
Thanks so much, Ian, for this perspective. Francesco, just very quickly.
Yeah, it's a very good question. It's something we are also thinking about and investigating. I would say that the key point for answering this question is understanding two things, whether the region which needs hydrogen and is willing to pay this hydrogen has enough hydrogen or needs to have imports because it cannot cover its demand. And this is a likely possibility in the near future, especially. And the second point is whether you can provide hydrogen at a cost which is cheaper than the cost of hydrogen production in the point of demand, and consider also the cost of transport. So this is really the margin within which the market for renewable hydrogen is defined. I think in the world there are definitely opportunities for this, also far away from Europe, at least it seems like.
Thank you very much indeed, and we certainly will get back to you. The final set of presentation, lighting talk, include insight from developing country. It is my pleasure now to introduce Ranjit Deshmukh, who is associate professor in environmental study at the University of Santa Barbara. So he's from the other side of the West Coast. And his work, most interesting from us, is also including looking and investigating at MAP renewable energy platform that enable to identify with really very high spatial resolution the opportunities for renewable energy. And Ranjit, the floor is yours. Thank you.
Great. Just give me a second while my, okay. Can you see my presentation?
Perfect, thank you.
Wonderful. Well, thanks, Maria, and thanks for the opportunity to present at this conference and to all the organizers. Today, I'm just going to talk about decarbonizing India's electricity sector. Just want to jump right in. So as a motivation, India is the third largest greenhouse gas emitter in the world today. It's about 6% of annual global GHG emissions in 2016. One third of these emissions were from coal-based electricity.
And Ranjit, just to interrupt, can you try to put it on a full screen? Because we can see only part of the presentation. I thought it was only momentarily. Sorry again for the interruption.
Oh, fascinating. Sorry about that. It is actually on my other screen then. Give me one second.
Oh, sure. Take your time. Otherwise, we can project centrally. It works perfectly. Million of thanks. Perfect. And sorry again for
interrupting. No worries. I couldn't find my desktop too for some reason. Okay. So the main motivation is that, you know, majority of the emissions are coming from coal-based electricity, one third of India's emissions. And the per capita emissions and energy use is quite low compared to global averages, but that suggests a massive growth potential. At the same time, all of us know there's a rapid decline in wind, solar, PV, and battery storage technology costs, and that provides alternatives to fossil fuel-based electricity generation. And it's not lost upon Indian policymakers. There are clean energy or clean electricity goals for India. The target was 175 gigawatts by 2022 and another 400 to 500 gigawatts of renewable energy by 2030. In this presentation, I'll use the term VRE, variable renewable energy, to refer to wind and solar. Okay, so what I'm going to present today is our results from a forthcoming paper. And the questions that we asked here were, what targets for wind and solar capacity have the lowest associated integration costs by 2030? Will these targets significantly offset the need to build fuel-generated electricity capacity? And what additional measures can we take to mitigate these VRE integration costs? Link framework, just briefly, like there are three main components. We have a really high spatial resolution VRE site selection and cost model, where we select the best wind and solar sites across the country, across the region. And then those feed into this capacity investment model that chooses conventional electricity capacity, basically gas and coal, given so much wind and solar capacity that we are putting on the system. And then it goes into a hourly system operations unit commitment and economic dispatch model to understand how much the whole system will cost for dispatching. The scenarios for 2030 that we are considering are three main VRE targets: 200 gigawatts, 400 gigawatts, and 600 gigawatts. And within those, we have five different mixes of solar. So 100% of wind versus 0% of solar, to 100% solar, 0% wind in 25% increments. And then these are sort of the sub scenarios. And then we have a host of different technical, economic, and policy scenarios that we simulate for all these 15 scenarios. These 15 sub scenarios of VRE targets are compared to corresponding scenario that has no renewable energy installed. So that gives us a sense of, you know, how much are the costs or benefits of pursuing a particular renewable energy target with a particular mix. Alrighty. So the first insight that we got from our spatial analysis, which is probably not too surprising, is that there's abundant wind and solar resources exist in India. If you see the plot on the left-hand side, plot C, you'll see the two supply curves for wind in blue and solar in orange. And the 600 gigawatt vertical line is shown here. So we have plenty of resources. Of course, this depends on the land use factor assumptions in our analysis. And we used, you know, values from the literature. So that's the first insight. The plot D shows the costs that we are including in our analysis. And these come from the solar and wind auctions that we have seen in India. We assume a flat real cost across 2030, as well as a low cost scenarios for both wind and solar. Now, the next set of results that I want to show have this particular format that you see in plot C here. So I'll be showing the three targets, which are indicated at the top: 200 gigawatts, 400 gigawatts, and 600 gigawatt targets. And for each of these targets, again, there are these five sub-scenarios that I mentioned before, going from all wind, more wind, balanced, which is the same wind and solar targets, more solar, and then all solar targets. So each of these points show a particular sub-scenario. Now, in this base scenario, what we're showing here is the VRE share of total electricity generation. As you can see, the all wind scenarios have the maximum share in wind, and in high VRE target scenarios, the more wind, which is 75% wind and 25% solar, has the highest share. The dotted line is the potential VRE generation, while the dark lines are actual VRE generation after curtailment. Now, there are three different metrics that we estimated. In plot A, we show the average direct cost of VRE. So those are the costs of installing that particular VRE target. And then the B and D plots show the capacity value of a VRE sub-scenario, which means how much savings you get by installing variable renewable energy and avoiding conventional generation capacity. So that's the capacity value. And then plot D, it's the energy value, which is the savings that you get by VRE electricity generation by avoiding conventional energy generation. So that's the energy value. And the dots, the solid dots, show the most desired renewable energy mix within each of the targets. So obviously the lowest points in the direct costs are the most desirable, where the highest dots in the capacity value and energy value are the most desirable in terms of benefits. So stemming from this, insight number two, which comes from plot B here, shows that the capacity value of VRE is really low in India. We compared these values against your values from Europe and the US, it's about a fifth. It just says that, you know, even the best case scenario, the capacity value is about less than 10 US dollars per megawatt hour of VRE generation. In other words, in simpler terms, it means even large wind and solar capacities displace only a small fraction of fossil fuel generation requirements. It's the nature of the VRE generation profiles within India. Another plot that highlights this is plot A, which on the y-axis is the conventional capacity avoided in megawatts per VRE megawatt installed. So in the best case scenario, in a 200 gigawatts or low VRE target, it means only 10% of that VRE target capacity, conventional capacity is avoided. But as you install more and more VRE resources, that capacity value also falls. In terms of actual gigawatts, you can imagine even after installing 600 gigawatts of VRE, at the most we can get about 27 odd gigawatts of avoided conventional capacity, okay? And this mainly comes from coal in India because gas is quite expensive. India doesn't have much gas resources, and most of the new capacity would have to rely on imported LNG, liquefied natural gas.
And Ranjit, just to warn you that you might need to wrap up.
So really quickly, insight number three. So these are the main results on, so it compares the cost of avoided emissions. And we had a host of different scenarios here, battery storage, low coal, minimum generation levels, future demand profiles, as well as high coal costs. The dots are the lowest costs of emitting carbon emissions. And what we saw across all these scenarios is that the optimal shares of wind and solar in India's 2030 low carbon electricity mix were either balanced or majority wind mixes, which means they fall on the middle lines or the left lines and not the solar majority mixes, which is in this last line. And to remind you, India's renewable energy targets are solar majority. And the last insight I want to provide is that battery storage can provide peak capacity, but is cost optimal only at the low end of forecast costs, which is about 150, which is shown by this green line for battery storage. And that's because we lose energy through the discharge and charging efficiency. And these are sort of the same conclusions that I want to, that I presented right now. A balanced and more wind capacity mix is the cheapest. It suggests India revisiting its solar majority targets. VRE sources have low capacity value and likely to displace only a small share of fossil fuel capacity requirements. Low-cost battery storage could be cost-effective, but we should definitely explore demand response opportunities. I want to acknowledge Duncan Calloway, my co-author, as well as the Power Systems Operations Corporation of India for their data. Thank you.
Thanks very much indeed, Ranjit, for such a rich presentation and the use of very highly spatial resolution, which I'm sure would be interesting for a lot of other countries. And we know that you're also working in Africa and many other developing regions. Now it's my pleasure to turn to Jeff Steinbuch, that is from our own economist from the bank. And as we know that economic incentive and policy really makes a difference in terms of attracting renewable energy. We heard from Ranjit the experience of one country that has selected and went from feed-in tariff to auction. Let's see instead now the case of Ukraine. Jeff, the floor is yours.
Yes, Marie, can you hear me? Can you hear me?
Perfectly. Please go ahead. The floor is all yours.
Thank you very much, Maria. I'm very pleased to use the opportunity to speak at this conference. This is a joint work with Javier Linon from the World Bank Energy and Extractive Consultant. And this stems for some earlier operational work we did for Ukraine last year. However, this is an academic piece and results are still preliminary. So any subsequent comments are very welcome. The topic of the paper is how much did feed-in tariffs cost Ukraine power sector. So I will start with making an important observation that over the last 10 years, we had a significant decline in the cost of many renewables. And the most drastic decline was in the cost of solar photovoltaics. The levelized cost of electricity for solar photovoltaics dropped from upper $300-$350 per megawatt to $50 per megawatt. It's a drastic decline. As a result, many developed countries decided to gradually phase out the support for solar power. Feed-in tariffs were extremely popular in early 2010s. However, by mid-2010s, most developed economies phased them out or put them close to zero. That said, some developing countries, and including Ukraine, the country I spent working on, still rely on feed-in tariffs as policy instruments. In Ukraine in particular, as of 2016, feed-in tariffs were sitting at close to $200 per megawatt hours, which is extremely generous. And in fact, last year, Ukraine's feed-in tariffs were the most generous in Europe. Not surprisingly, when we have the size of FIT exceeding the lowest cost of electricity by nearly three times, investment in solar photovoltaics becomes very attractive. So starting from 2018, the investment in solar photovoltaics went over the roof. And capacity, installed capacity moved up from less than 1 gigawatt to more to about 5 gigawatts, and the investment kept coming. Seeing that feed-in tariffs becoming very expensive for the Ukrainian government, the government took a drastic reduction in FITs, and in fact, they retroactively amended power purchasing agreements for existing renewables, which was obviously costly. In that sense, Ukrainian government wasn't unique by all means. The same problems with feed-in tariffs went earlier in Germany and in Spain. And the economic inefficiencies due to both inflexibility and incentive issues are very well recognized by the energy economics literature. However, there are very few, if any, studies that actually try to quantify the loss to inflexible and inefficient feeds. So this study offers the first comprehensive sector level assessment, and by sector level I mean the power sector assessment, due to inefficient feed-in tariffs. So how we approach the problem and how we arrive to our results. The idea is to use the energy optimization model, that's World Bank energy planning model, which can calculate optimal power section expansion for the next 2 decades. The model takes a number of parameters, including techno-economic characteristics, future forecasts of power demand, profiles of renewables, transmission constraints, and delivers a number of things, including yearly capacity mix, energy mix, system total cost, wholesale prices. Thanks to our extensive work and help from operations, we managed to collect highly accurate data from Ukrainian government agencies, including the regulator and transmission system operator, as well as energy utilities. So the model is very accurately calibrated and delivers fairly solid results. So how do we use the model to answer the question at hand? I played the same trick as in an earlier paper that I wrote from Harold back in 2015. So essentially we solved the model based on 2018 input data. Remember that most of the solar investment came up after 2018. 2018 to 2020 was the time when the solar went through the roof. So at that point of time there was very little investment made. And then I solved the calibrated and sold the same model based on the 2019 input data when there was already a lot of solar installed and as much solar commissioned. So we had very clear understanding how much solar will be coming into the feed-in tariffs. And then we difference the results to obtain the effects of feed-in tariffs and capacities, energy mix, cost, and wholesale prices. Now, it's also important that future is uncertain. So if we do it only for one scenario, the results would likely be incorrect. So we repeat these steps for different scenarios. And in this current setup, we have six different scenarios, starting from business as usual assumptions, what the Ukrainian government assumes is right, going to a higher demand for electricity, Ukraine integration in power and European grid, which should give a greater flexibility to local power sector, a renewables mandate, carbon tax, and flat coal, which actually comes with larger and more expensive prices. So what we see here, these results show the difference between the two model runs for business as usual scenario. And we see from this chart that if we run the model 2018, we see significant overinvestment in renewable capacity. Then it's optimally needed. We have more than 9 gigawatts investment, and most of that is coming from solar, but also partially of wind and also from storage, which is necessary for balancing, as Ranjit pointed out in his presentation just a couple of minutes ago. Going from capacities to costs, I think this is a key graph I want to show you. This is basically tell us the range of losses under different set of scenarios. And we see that for most of the scenarios, the range of losses comes in the range of $8 million, so $8 billion over the course of next 20 years. The losses are considerably smaller if we introduce the renewable energy policy or if we introduce a carbon tax. They nearly halve. But they are still there largely due to inefficient allocation of capex. So basically the model tells us that solar PV is not the most efficient way of dealing with renewables in the Ukraine. As expected, you know, more renewables delivers carbon savings and it also delivers reduction in fuel. So we use less coal and natural gas and saving carbon. This is however not sufficient to offset the high cost of capex and operational costs. What do we learn from that? We learn from there that excessively feeding tariffs cost Ukraine power sector anywhere between $4.7 to $7.9 billion over the next two decades. That's $235 to $400 million per annum. That's not a small amount for a poor country like Ukraine. There are some gains due to carbon benefits and lower fuel costs, but they are not sufficient to be upset to materialize due to higher capex, operation maintenance, and balancing costs. Moreover, these estimates are likely to be the lower bound because feed-in tariffs results in higher prices. So there are indirect costs of the rest of the economy, and power sector is not necessarily optimally managed as our model would predict. So this is really a lower bound. The main takeaway in terms of policy recommendations is if you want to support energy transitions and achieve decarbonization, we probably want more flexible schemes like energy options and carbon taxes. I think I'm done and I'm seriously out of time. Thanks so much.
Thank you so much, Jeff, for such a fascinating presentation. I know that we're already running out of time, but we started a little bit early. So first of all, I would like to extend my special thanks to all the panelists for really coping with such a short, very succinct, but so fascinating presentation. Perhaps if we have, I would encourage everyone, you know, to submit any other question. But just to start, I would like to ask Ranjit, perhaps turn to him, the same question that has been asked before. Since you mentioned, and during your simulation, you also look at the possibility or the introduction of energy storage in the case of India, how promising you could say that the role of storage was? Can you really recommend it in terms of cost effectiveness? And perhaps in the case of Jev, if I may just start the conversation, is have you estimated, you gave us like the bulk, back to the envelope estimation of the total cost implied by feed-in tariff. But perhaps can you give us, some ideas on how much this is per megawatts per hour? Because, for instance, there have been some fascinating work in the case of Brazil that had actually switched from feed-in tariff to auction that had been really comparing the two solutions. So they provided some kind of benchmark in terms of per unit cost. Let me start with Ranjit. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Maria. So I would definitely have the Indian government pursue energy storage options, especially because we are going to expect lower battery costs. Again, like our assumptions on discharge and charging efficiencies were, fairly conservative. So as we improve efficiencies in the energy storage, we'll lose less energy, and battery storage will definitely provide more services. Another main point I want to make is we only looked at how batteries could provide energy and capacity value, but not other services that batteries can provide, like resiliency and reserves, or avoidance of transmission or distribution infrastructure. And battery storage basically gives this whole suite, and to comprehensively look at this particular solution, you want to value all of these different streams.
Fantastic.
And then just one last point is that's the main, battery storage or energy storage solutions are like the main solution that might avoid fossil fuel generation capacity within India, because we don't have much gas in India, and it's all based on LNG, so that's going to be really expensive.
Thank you so much. And Jeff, now I'm turning back to you.
Thanks, Maria. This is an excellent question. I don't have the numbers in hand in terms of how much it's in terms of per megawatt. However, if I can somehow come back to my previous slide and share. So we see that we are adding about 9 extra gigawatts in business as usual. And the costs are somewhere in the ballpark of $4.7 to $7.1 billion. So if you divide these numbers by 9, you will get the dollar per kilowatt, and then that's that would be the cost we're talking about in the roughest estimate. I think that your suggestion of simulating results for energy auctions and comparing with the feed-in tariffs would be amazing, and it's an excellent suggestion. And I would love to do that, and if you could share the paper, I would be certainly interested in replicating. Thank you so much.
No, thank you so much. This is really like a great opportunity to hear in from all of you the latest work, and it's been really a fascinating opportunity for everyone. As I can see that we are already running out of time and there are no question and answer, I would like first of all to extend to all of you my special thanks. This has been a very challenging request from our side. To really concentrate a very rich presentation, but provided just few key takeaways. We will definitely would like to continue to stay in touch with you and explore any further opportunities for collaboration. But I would think in general, a key takeaway that is coming throughout the presentation and the keynote, starting from the keynote speech this morning in the energy sector, are really very encouraging. It seems really that the energy sector, and particularly electricity, has been one of the most dynamic sectors. And there are indeed opportunities to leapfrog some of the new technology for the advantage of developing country. And certainly, I would like to close thanking everyone. I would like to extend my special thanks to our colleagues that have been working so hard from the other side of the West Coast. We will never be able really to host this event, particularly given the challenges and to have to go virtual. Their intellectual and technical leadership, because they've also been handling all the technical solution for us, has been fascinating. And we really hope that this will be just the beginning of this collaboration. So these are really the concluding session. I would like to extend special thanks for all the audience that has stayed online for so long. In many cases, really like without having any break, not even for lunch, within the concentrated and compacting time. And I would like really to extend a special thanks for and hope to host you next year for the next annual conference. So on those notes, I would like to thank you very much, and we can conclude this session. Thank you all.